do is take my body home. Well, well, well.
Along tonight, for those who don't know me, my name is Ralph Hobbs. You, of course, know George Giddos. Don't be in fear of the guitar, I'm not going to play it.
This is how we pose together.
This particular thing,
that again.
This is the artist-dealer relationship.
Yeah, exactly.
Just the two.
The little Shazia and my war dog. Shazia in the film Snow Monkey, our latest movie, it's a love story, and she's the girlfriend of Steel, and we've got a little picture of Steel over here, Stainless Steel, the gangster. And I thought that Steel was a monster, you know, he sort of goes around with a razor blade in his mouth, and he's got a gang, and he'll cut people up, you know, and then I discovered that he was in love. And one day he said, George, I want to show something to you and Shazia. And he took us down to the river, and he took us this huge house, which is owned by the Minister for Customs. So you understand a country where opium and heroin is the main thing. The richest man there is the customs chief. And he looked at Shazia with tears in his eyes. He said, someday this is going to be yours, Shazia. And she looked at him and said, but how are you going to do it? And he said, I'll find a way. And Shazia is there. She's always trying different angles. Her father's in jail, and she has to find the money to feed her brothers and sisters. And she was having a go that day at being a shoeshine girl. And one of my favourite paintings is Otto Dix's painting of the match site boys selling matches. And these children are really war orphans, and they're having to live off the street.
So I can die easy.
Had not been killed, and he couldn't understand war. And so here it was, in front of the ruins, pining for the family to come back, but would never come back. So just as I sat down and drew Shazia, I sat down and drew that pup. And the pup has kind of haunted me, because Helen and I already owned two of these pups that were war orphan pups. And I left it there, and as a result, I ended up writing a long story, like, you know, the story of the red dog in the movies. And that's going to be our first comic. And so tonight, we're also announcing that we've started a new comic book company, Night Vision Comics, and the first comic is War Dog. How these paintings came about was, Helen and I were in London painting. I was doing the portrait of my friend Julian Assange in the Ecuador embassy. And I couldn't take oil paints in there because he's on a very, you know, like the stink of Giddos's turpentine could have been the last straw that got Julian kicked out of the embassy. So I had it painted in gesso, you know. I don't normally use acrylic black and white gesso. And when I finished it, I sent the pictures of it to a great American art historian, David Gross. And he came back and he said, a terrific portrait for a terrible time. And everyone I know in America is mourning the fact that our mate Donald Trump has now got his finger on the nuclear trigger. Yeah. So we went directly from London to our Yellow House in Afghanistan, which is an artist collective that we fund and support and create in Jalalabad. And the first thing I did was a second portrait of Julian, because he thought it would be a great thing if I could do a big picture of him on the roof of the Yellow House, underneath the flight path of the American attack helicopters. And pretty soon, like, you know, Julian Assange, they're spending £7 million a year surveilling him. So the Americans had all been briefed that George Giddos was doing a giant Julian Assange picture on the roof of the Yellow House. So there were these shoppers are hovering there, and you see the flashlights going off. We became a tourist attraction for returning special forces. The occasional drone was circling us. And Julian loved that. And then he said, well, George, can you find out what the people of Jalalabad really think of me? So I got the two big panels, and I put them on the back of like a rickshaw cart, And we went through Jalalabad, and everyone was sticking up, good on you, Julian. And it turns out that most people, even though a lot of Australians don't know who Julian Assange is, everyone in Jalalabad did, because they see him as the one man who on his own has been able to prepare to stand up against America. And to them, that's, they admire courage. They don't understand his politics, but they admire that courage. And so the next one I did was Donald Trump. And I did it simultaneously with Locking Horns. And the amazing thing tonight, I think it's probably the first time I've ever been able to do this. It was only a dream. We have recorded it all in virtual reality. So after our talk, you're going to be able to download it onto your smartphone and watch me painting these pictures in virtual reality. And you'll be there. You'll be able to look around at the sky and the walls, and you'll be able to be on the top of the Yellow House. And this is one of the paintings I was doing, and it's in Afghanistan. There's a lot of, you know, we own a couple of goats that never stop butting heads, and so that's where it came from. And I think we're in a world where it's divided, you know, black against white, Israeli against Palestinian, liberal against conservative, and Muslim against Christian. And no one's getting anywhere. The world's not progressing. We're not seeing the end of environmental damage. We're still using coal and everything else. Nothing's happening because of this locking of horns. The interesting thing is one of my great inspirational artists is Goya. And just in his Los Caprichos, he did 80. And they're really the first graphic novel. And so me getting back into trying to create graphic novels has opened the whole thing. Anyone who went to school with me would have seen me drawing monsters all the time. I used to entertain the other kids in class. I've always been I love doing monsters. And the other monster in the show is Leadership, which is the big one down on the wall there. And that's taking one of my favourite monsters is Dürer's wonderful early drawing of a rhino. He gives a couple of extra horns. And the head of Christ, which is also a great, the dead Christ, great drawing of Dürer's on its back. And it's got one foot that's like Hillary's stiletto and the other one Trump's foot. And it's this world which is in a crisis of leadership. I mean, we're seeing people aren't really voting for Trump. They just want to throw a hand grenade at the politicians who screwed everything up. And it's the same with Brexit. So it's just look at Malcolm Turnbull, my God. It's a world where there's a crisis of leadership, so I just wanted to embody that with a single image. I've been using glitter from the beginning, you know, they used to call me Georgie Glitter. Gittos, it's a bit like glitter, isn't it? The politicians like Trump and so on are so superficial that it was extremely appropriate to use glitter, particularly the big one, Trump. But my sister Pamela is here, and I grew up doing etchings, and this work is inspired by Goya. And Goya invented the aquatint, where you block out the actual drawing, and then you put a powder of resin over it, you bake it, and you put it in the acid so that you get this contrasting black background. My sister Pam taught me to do this. And so there's no equivalent to that in painting, but glitter works that way. So this to me is like putting an aquatint in an etching.
So it gets a tonal.
Yeah, if I did an etching, I would put an aquatint in there where the glitter is. So it's a process that I love.
Painting words in the air tonight, so we've got our easel. From the moon.
I made the film Rampage 12 years ago in Miami. And if you watch that, you'll see Reverend Johnny Davis, who's it's like a scene out of the Blues Brothers. And recently, I pitched to Johnny Davis that there was this great gospel singer in Australia, Helen. And so he's about to start a revival meeting around the South. And Helen's the great Australian gospel singer that's going to be leading it. So there's going to be some day when I walk down and I'll see Helen getting onto the bus with all these amazing black singers, and she'll be going off to teach the gospel.
Can we talk a little bit more about Goyer and his influence on you, in particular in his later years? Because we've had this conversation over time, and I find it fascinating because he's one of those guys who always told the truth visually, and I think that's a big part of your career as a painter.
When he did those paintings about war, he said, "I've been there, I've seen this, I know this, I witnessed this." And I've done a painting really dedicated to all brave artists and to Goyer. It's this one around here, and it's called The Choice. And I took a comfortable chair, which Brett Whiteley painted in a lovely soft landscape, and I put it in the background because Brett was actually talking about Matisse, who said that art should be like a comfortable chair. You should just go in there, it shouldn't provoke you, it shouldn't make you think, you should just relax with it and enjoy it. But there's another kind of artist that goes out and does battle. And that's what Goyer did, and a lot of artists like Otto Dix, Max Beckman, many artists, Banksy these days. And so there's two kinds of artists. You've got the choice. And I think culture needs both of them. This is called The Great Mystery. And there's two kinds of great mysteries. It's my favourite painting in the show, actually. I've been evolving it for a long time. There's the fetus shape in the bottom, which I've taken from Audrey Beardsley. And there's the red skull, and there's a helicopter with the cross. And then there's this mystical Muhammad figure. And really what we're seeing in Afghanistan is two great religions, Christianity and Islam, coming head to head. And they both believe in the same God, the same paradise, you know, the same background in the Old Testament. They both, they love the same characters from the Bible. And yet it hasn't brought unity. And so that's a mystery as well, that these great religions at this time, when they should be uniting around the common belief in a single God, at the center of the conflict that we're seeing in Afghanistan. And that is the great mystery. Do we live beyond death? And what's happening with me is that at the moment I'm painting a lot of mystical paintings. I've come out as a mystic. I think if gays can come out as gays, mystics can come out as mystics. Like we're coming out a bit later. And I remember I rang someone and they read one of my Facebook things about being a mystic, and they recommended I read a few books on schizophrenia. That's how our society views it, you know. There's always been mystics. You go to New Guinea, and there'll be a couple of schizophrenics. There'll be a couple of gays. There'll be a couple of this and that. There's also a couple of mystics. They might be called shaman or witch doctors or whatever. So yes, I think you know the world needs its mystics. I think humanity will get very out of whack. If I read this terrible book by what's the guy that. Physicist Hawkins, yes, and where he's claiming that physicists know the truth and that there's nothing beyond physics, and you know we don't need to look at the mystics or the poets, but I think all of art is proof that there's something beyond this reality, and that's what artists have done, great musicians, writers, poets, painters, yeah. And so that's what that painting is about. Which ain't the diary. So the budding heads I drew on the plane between London and Jalalabad and Kabul, and they all originate the diaries. Even this sketch of Bulldog, I sketched him into my diary. And but we've got wonderful Greg Waite here and Johnny Lewis, who are two of the original Yellow House artists, and along with Albie Toms and and Antoinette Starkovich and Martin Sharp and everyone at the Yellow House, we were inspired by Vincent van Gogh. But it wasn't just, you know, that's why we called the Yellow House the Yellow House, because Vincent believed of a place where artists would come together and work with each other to create something more marvellous than one person could do on their own. And we're now doing that in Afghanistan. But the other inspiration for us, of course, was Vincent's letters. Martin wove them through our catalogues. And I believe that the journey that an artist takes through their life, all of their works are illustrations of that journey. So now if you visit the Van Gogh Museum in Amsterdam, they've actually got all of his paintings and drawings, and they've put them together with the letters, exactly, you know, the letters that he wrote. And it becomes a narrative. Once again, it becomes like a graphic novel. So Ralph's right, I feel that every painting and drawing I've done since I was a kid is an illustration of my journey through life.
To finish our conversation, there are a couple of works I'd just like to talk about. There's the three clown figures here, and also the Lincoln painting.
When we were in Miami during the Trump election, and we made a video clip, an anti-Trump video clip, with Trigger Trig, and it's called "You All Don't Hear Me," and it was about, you know, the reaction of the black community to someone who actually endorses the Ku Klux Klan. And I went out and bought these masks. But I chose masks. You know, one looked like Tillman, the Secretary of State. One looks like Steve Bannon. And one looked like Pence, the vice president. So they're Trump's three clowns. So we've got Trump there, and we've got Trump's closest advisors. And I think now we've got a Joker in the White House. It's straight out of Marvel Comics. And it's like the end of democracy. There's Abe Lincoln, who fought the Civil War to bring about equal rights for blacks, and now we've got a very different America. So the film that we're about to make is called White Light, and I made Rampage in about 12 years ago, and one of the black soldiers in America, Elliot Lovett, I went on a couple of missions with him, and being with him is like a panther moving through houses, you know, fighting this war. And when he came back, he said, "George, I want you to come to a rap battle." And I said, "What's that?" You know, and I came in, and it's where the soldiers come and they sort of take off their aggression in a verbal fight. And Elliot demolished all of them. And I said, "Oh my God, Elliot, you're a genius." Like, with words, he could sculpture images in space equal to Picasso's sculptures. And I said, "It's such a waste, you know, you're fighting George Bush's war." And he laughed at me. He said, "No, George, it's much more dangerous in Miami where I came from." And so I followed him back to Miami, and his real agenda was to get me to help his brother Marcus, who was a very short time, Marcus was murdered by a child assassin. And I realised when I was making Rampage that was a film about how child assassins are being used, because in the black community, these kids can kill someone, be paid to do it by the drug gangs, and they go in and out of juvie because they're too young to go to jail. And that's how guardian angels protecting me all the time. And my life has become more and more dangerous every day. Like recently, just as we finished these paintings, my best friend, Maulana Haqqani, IS attacked his house and killed his brother trying to kill him. They could try and whack the Yellow House any day because we stand for everything they hate. And they've just attacked the television station in Jalalabad and killed five of our friends who work in the film industry. So the world is getting darker and darker. And so 20 years ago, after I'd survived the Kibeho massacre in Rwanda, where I saw thousands of people killed, I thought, "George, it can never get worse than this," but it is getting worse. We're living in an era where we've got the Joker with his hand, you know, fingers on the nuclear buttons. You know, we could have a nuclear war. When I wake up in the morning these days, I say, "Helen, I'll turn the TV on and see if we've had a nuclear war yet." And Bannon, his advisors, recommending that there will be a war with China within the next 10 years. Imagine what that would do to the world. So it's becoming a darker world. So the original painting 20 years ago had a yellow background, and I was bending back, dodging a bullet. And so I've revisited that, this very, very dark world, and once again dodging the bullet. So it's revisiting, staying alive in a much darker world.
Well, so I can die.